on your comment on Tim and Mark's book, and I'm very happy to be here, and I'm very grateful, especially to you too, because this book has been so interesting for me to read, and I'm very grateful to Juliet, as always, but also because she is the one who connected my work on Wittgenstein and Forms of Life, and this reflection on social media and perpetual contact. So this is, of course, I'm really not a specialist of these questions at all, but for me, they are really emblematic of the kind of work that can be done between sociology and philosophy, and also with communication science, which for me is also part of sociology and philosophy. And it's great to see this common work that you are producing, Juliet and Angie especially. Also because myself in France, I've been trying to do work with sociologists in various ways, and it's always, I know it's not easy, but I think it's the only way to go if you want to study this kind of reality. So to have this kind of realistic spirit in philosophy and sociology, you need to bring your forces together. So I've been doing work first on the ethics of care, and it was a book, and actually Vanessa was part of that too. And it was a collection I edited with French sociologist Patricia Paperman, who is also a sociologist influenced by Goffman and Garfinkel. So this was, of course, something that mattered. And there are these three books I wrote with Albert Rogien, and thank you so much, Juliet, for mentioning the last one. It's on democracy. And again, Albert Rogien is a sociologist that is influenced by Wittgenstein and Goffman and Garfinkel. So there is this kind of common school in philosophy and sociology that I feel is very much akin to the kind of approach you are defending, except that, of course, I was a little disappointed that it's not, it's completely normal that Wittgenstein is not yet present here, but it's obviously this is why we really want to mention this concept of form of life, and Goffman is often mentioned, so this is really nice, but maybe not as much as it could, because for me it's really very central to the kind of method, the method you are using here. And also, and Juliet mentioned it, I have been organizing this workshop since a couple of years on the idea of weak links using Radovetter work. And I was surprised that this paper by Radovetter is very much used in France, but not that much here in the US. And this is one of my questions, even if it doesn't have much to do with this book, but it's addressed to the sociologist here, is that someone like Goffman or someone like Radovetter, there's a lot of circulation of these works and discussion in some kind of sociology in France. Not everywhere, but it's sometimes, I feel it's easier to find books by Goffman in the French translations than here in the US. I was so surprised because Bourdieu, in his collection, Le Sens Commun, has had all Goffman's books translated very early, like in the 70s or 80s. Mm-hmm. And it was so very important for a whole generation of French sociologists and the Bourdieusian sociologists. So it's surprising. So I read all these books quite early, and when I came to the US, I thought I would find out the original, because I had read it in French, actually. I was looking for the original text, and I had really a hard time actually finding them. So it's very interesting. But anyway, what is common to these approaches, like Wittgenstein, Goffman, and Cavell too, is the idea that you find more in the observation of everyday life than in theories or idealizations of social life and concepts. And I think there is something very deep going on, and it's something this book is really exemplifying in the way you can use the attention, and so the full concept of attention to ordinary life, and the concept of the ordinary itself is something that completely transforms both sociology and philosophy. And so Cabert is very important there, and this is why I quote Wittgenstein and Cabert, so it's really a follow-up on what Juliet was telling us about forms of life. Attention to forms of life and to this whole array of activities. In the list you showed on your slide, I don't want to show it again, but you know, walking, chatting, playing, giving orders, kind of things. And obviously, in this list, you would have, you know, sending an email, giving a phone call, and all these kind of activities that are now as fundamental as acting in a play or singing rounds. I mean, the examples we can have here. So the fact that all this list of activities you were mentioning, and I like very much Hafer's list to make it work, is something that shows how important the concept of form of life is to what the book is about. So this is this attention to detail, and also the fact that this form of life, and Marx reminded it this morning anyway, it's a form of life in language. You don't have a form of life without this kind of agreement, Übereinstimmung. The agreement in language, and as you know very well, Juliet, you talk about logic a lot, this may seem to abolish logic, but no, of course, because this is what logic is in the later Wittgenstein approach. And so the idea that if you have this agreement, it's an agreement in language, but agreeing in language is an agreement in a form of life that implies other list of activities you gave us. And it is also something, and I'm just adding a kind of footnote to your comment here, it's something that doesn't preclude the idea that you have your own voice in this Übereinstimmung, in this agreement. And so this is what happens in the agreement in language, and this is what happens in the kind of practices and use as you're describing, is that of course there's a practice, and sometimes you find the word practice in Wittgenstein, you are exaggerating actually. So practice itself tells us whatever these activities are, and so you have these practices that somehow define a kind of framework for what you're doing. So this is also the theory, of course, your apparatized idea, but within this agreement you have your own voice, and you have your this kind of improvisation capacity that defines the kind of pragmatic approach that you are defending. So I think what you present is really a great enactment of the idea of form of life and the idea of practice as defining our concepts today. And this is why it's really complicated, and I agree completely on the fact that there is no satisfying theory in, for example, in a functionalist approach or cognitivist approaches of the subject. But it's really because if you want to have a correct approach, you have to have this kind of very practical, and I would say pragmatic. It's really the pragmatic approach both of philosophy and of sociology that can make you able to understand what is going on. And I use on purpose Goffman's expression, what is going on, and it's something that Bourdieu actually also uses, so it's something that is maybe a very strong point in sociology, and it's really also about calling attention. I just have one other picture. That's all. Okay. Calling. I don't have enough room for some reason. I have to do this full screen thing. Well, never mind. Yes, it's Emerson, because you quoted Thoreau in another. I think the second idea, the form of life, is the idea of the ordinary. I think attention to ordinary life is very central to what is at stake. Maybe I say in philosophy, because in sociology it may sound obvious, although it's not always the case. But anyway, the idea that the ordinary is the most important is something that is completely against the general conception of philosophy that is dominant, that was dominant in the historically dominant, but also, I think, contemporary philosophy. So this is what I owe to Wittgenstein and Cavell, and this is what brought me to, you know, working with sociologists, because philosophers were not interested in the matters I was interested in. And so you have this idea of the ordinary, and this is a quotation from Emerson, which is the kind of motto for other people who are interested in this concept of the ordinary. And then you have, I read it from the, okay, it's easier. So I embrace the common, I explore and sit at the feet of the familiar, the low, and what would we really know the meaning of? The meal in the firkin, the milk in the pan, the ballad in the street, the news of the boat, the glance of the eye, the form, and the gait of the body. So you see, this is really a kind of ontology of the ordinary, and you don't find this ontology in, you know, in Aristotle or Kant's categories, but they are really categories. And just one last thing, Cavell comments this and quotes Emerson and says this is something that is the physiognomy, so a kind of phenomenology of the ordinary. And so this is where there's this kind of convergence of philosophy and sociology, is with this kind of phenomenology of physiognomy, description of the ordinary. And this is something that is just not easy at all. And so this is why this kind of detail and description of everyday practices, like also the phone, and this is why I'm trying to say a few words on this question of the use of the portable or the cell phone, because this hasn't been obviously studied enough, and it's very strange, as you say, because this is not only something that has been introduced in our form of life and kind of fitted in, but this is something that it's completely redefining the human form of life, and everywhere, especially your book is very, actually it's really kind of remarkable, because there's a kind of prophetic aspect, because everything is true, or even if it's not true, it's even truer now, because you really, other chapters themselves, they really show how this technology is kind of growing, and so some of the paper are studying what is happening in the late 90s, and in the late 90s they say, you know, there's 1/3 of people who have this cell phone, and it's so amazing, but of course it gets much bigger figures, but this is something that you really describe, so it's very it's very, very important, but also you show how this is completely changing the way people live. But to understand that, you have to pay attention to ordinary, everyday life, and especially to what is happening, not only in the public space, which is of course very important, and this is what the government is about, you know. So people giving phone calls in restaurants and so on, but also what is happening at home in the private space. And so this kind of sociology, if you pay attention to this kind of private life and the intersection between the private and the public life that is really created by the cell phone, there you understand also some kind of very important changes which are both theoretical and practical, which bring the private at the center of the attention that was before devoted to the public. And this is something that is very important also, maybe I mentioned it because it hasn't been mentioned yet, about all the issues of gender. I was very interested in the book to understand that the early users, like in the 90s and 2000, of cell phones were women. It was first professional men, you know, so the man who, the important man who has the cell phone in the team, which you described at the beginning, and also women. And I think it is really very lucky that this cell phone thing has been very widely used now, so completely very general, you know, men, women, younger people, older people, because if it had, were limited to women, I don't know if you would have written this book, because, for example, something like the washing machine, it changes the form of life, but you don't have such impact. In theory, it has a huge impact in everyday life, but not in theory. So the mobile phone.
In self-defense, I've written on women and the telephone before writing about mobile phones.
Yes, that sounds. That's very true. But it's very interesting. There are several studies in the book, because I'm very interested in other field work in the book, in various countries about, you know, how women would use these phones to coordinate professional life, private life, to, you know, check on their husbands and children and so on. So it's something that is really very central to this kind of also empowerment of women, and it's something that is really very well described, and that is not very often at the center of description. So, for example, I'm very interested in all these kind of small interviews you have of women doing like when they are doing shopping. And they get a phone call and so on. Because of course it's something that is that has changed, I guess, because you have, I think it's in the Lycop, because I read, I'm very nationalist, so I read also the French article, the Lycop and Hertin. Their study is really interesting, not only because it's about France, but also because Lycop and Hertin have this kind of ethnomethodological approach, and so of course they are very close to both to Wittgenstein and your style of inquiry. And so, for example, women explaining that when they are doing shopping and receive a phone call in the supermarket, they are kind of embarrassed and forget. And they explain they forget everything. Yes, I was shopping. I was filling up my caddy, and the girlfriend calls me, and I say, you know, I'm shopping, and so on. And so she says she was slightly embarrassed at the beginning, and then one forgets, one gets into the car. And so women being so engrossed into the car that they forget that they are at the supermarket, but actually many of us here give phone calls at the supermarket without feeling embarrassed at all. So I thought it was really really interesting to have all these women kind of, you know, witnessing to these evolutions. And you were mentioning, David, the fact that it's a kind of universal fact that in restaurants we don't like you know, to talk aloud on their phones and the restaurants. We didn't mention this. It's a kind of, and this is something that is really at the center, at the core of many, discussions here. Like in the restaurants, I hate this, it works. Then anything, they should put up signs forbidding the use of mobile phones in restaurants. I don't know why, but it bothers me much less in bars. And so I think this is something that obviously hasn't changed. People still dislike conversation in restaurants. It's still annoying, but actually they're not annoyed by the fact that someone puts it. His or her phone on the table in the restaurant. You, when you're in the restaurant, you see phones on the table, and no one resents this. That means that there is this evolution, of course, since the book, and it's not a criticism at all, because it's, for me, it's a confirmation, but I think maybe there's some work to do about that. The fact that now there's so much about, you know, texting and everything, and we'll be much more discreet, because people will just, you know, have a look and text and so on, instead of bothering everyone with a loud conversation and so on. But is it better or not? What does it mean? I think it's really a very some kind of very small points, but which would need each of them to be studied. This is what Keller says, you know, we would need a transcendental deduction for every word, and we would need a study for all these facts. Also the fact, because in my seminar on weak links, I had a presentation by a sociologist about what is happening now with phones and kids and so on, because in the book, it's really interesting because it's the beginning of the cell phone thing, and people have cell phones, but it's more for the private thing and private life, more connected to private life. This is why women actually use them. Now everyone has a cell phone, but in the 90s or 2000s, as you describe it, people didn't, it was kind of, you know, problem to call someone her cell phone if you didn't know her. And now, actually, it has become much easier to call someone on her cell phone than to call her at home, which is the home number. So this kind of reversal is, I think, very interesting for this kind of frontier between private and public. And the fact that the portable phone has become kind of more public object, and I also, in this presentation by this French sociologist, I was very interested by the fact that you all know this, it's really, it's just, you know, ordinary observation, but the fact that now kids, the younger people, they will never use their phone to talk. I mean, it's something completely impossible. I mean, for anyone under 20, and you know, you, when you were mentioning, you know, you tell your daughter to call her grandmother, try to do that too. Can you know, speak to have her speak on the phone? I mean, it's kind of, and they don't even call their friends for conversation. They text, they will text, and then to give a call, and not only on the, you know, regular phone or cell phone, but to have a conversation on the phone is something that is basically disappearing. And so I really want to know, of course, your take on that, because it's, of course, you can say it's too bad, but also it's very interesting to notice that the written, of course, the written language is now kind of, you know, superseding and in this kind of communication, and this is something that is really very consistent for me with your description. And so so this was the first point I wanted to make. I have a second point, but I tried to make it quick. It's really about also what is very important is the book. In the book, even if it's not completely explicit, it's the idea of an ethical texture of life, specific texture, that is brought, that brought up by this kind of this existence of cell phone, mobile phone exchanges. So of course there's all these Goffmanian situations we just mentioned, people talking too loud, people talking in the on their phone in buses or trains, which was really at the center of the discussions in the book. And so I think it's very, of course, it's very, very Goffmanian, and also it's very appropriate to the situation in public, using public space for private conversations, because there is this kind of risk to the kind of civil indifference that is, you know, promoted in this kind of space. And so the intrusion on the personal space of surrounding travelers, and so embarrassment, offense, and so on. So this is very, some very, very good illustration of Goffman, and it is also something that shows the ethical character of the social interaction. Very, because there is, of course, in the bus, you know, when you exchange glances with the others, and it's kind of disapproval. So of course, there is a very strong moral judgment for this kind of ordinary actions. And of course, if you are interested, like Pauline was describing about, you know, ordinary ethics in ordinary situations, as they are, for example, shown on TV shows or in film. And so the whole Kaber study of the way film and ordinary situation kind of exude some kind of ethics. This is a very, of course, the best way to go. So in one of the chapters, you have this story about people yelling at one another on the phone at the Pizza Hut. Oh, someone screaming, "Who do you take me for? I know you got a wife in Africa," and so, an Asian girl. So it's very racial. But anyway, and so, and the woman who tells the story says, you know, even speaking in a normal tone on the phone, people can hear, even if everybody is eating, oh no, I would be too embarrassed. So this whole thing of embarrassment. And so I think this is extremely important, but it's something interesting to see at a distance, because maybe now this kind of embarrassment is less present, and maybe people have this kind of interactions, like either, you know, by text. And I don't know if it's so much better, actually. I mean, maybe you prefer the embarrassment. I know a woman who, you know, got dumped by an email or a text. They really don't like it. So it's better, even a phone call is better. But anyway, this is why there's always this kind of ethical dimension in all these descriptions of situations. And of course, it's also connected to this whole fantasy about, you know, people lying on the phone about where they are, which is also kind of early. And the fact that you cannot be located, which is a very interesting phenomenon that is described in the book in many of the studies. But this, and the whole guidance approach, the fact that, of course, you are not this kind of risk connected to the fact that you cannot locate exactly the person. And so this delocalization of human interactions is a kind of course, something connected to modernity, but also something that creates the need for more from some precision in the phone call. You need to tell where you are, and so on, and so that kind of a way to diminish this kind of risk or, you know, difficulty about that. But actually, so maybe this is still a question for you, actually. This has changed too. Maybe people are, you know, much the idea of not being able to locate someone is maybe different, not as strong now. And I think also there's something very interesting in this whole idea that is central to your approach and to the book, that of course you don't, it's not the same thing to have someone present, direct interaction, and to have an interaction with someone that is not there, as if the face-to-face direct interaction was something kind of basic and easy and transparent, which is, someone made this objection already, but I want just to put this a little further before finishing. So, as if the direct in-presence relationship was easy, which is not completely the case, and so myself, also, I mean, this is completely personal and very, very sub-empirical, but I guess you have also been also struck by this, maybe, that the fact that you are, when people are engrossed in a telephone call, like on the street and so on, and it's very difficult to stop this interaction. So even if they walk, they are on the phone and they walk, they see you and they haven't seen you for 10 years and they have written you mails telling you that they really want to see you, they won't stop the conversation. You know, that because it's when you are engrossed in the conversation, the other becomes much more important. So this is really, for me, still a mystery, because of course maybe it's because engaging it with an absent person, you know, mobilize so much energy and involvement that you don't want to somehow, you know, lose this. Or maybe at another level it's easier to, you know, to talk with someone.
It's cognitive process.
Exactly. So really, I know you have many things to tell about that, but I think this is a phenomenon that is really similar. I mean, that is a kind of constant, I think. So I really want to understand this constant. And I also have this interesting story about, you know, the fact, because usually in all these stories that people tell in surveys in France or Norway and so on, there's always the idea that when people are on the phone and address other people, of course it's very uncivil and impolite, and I think this is maybe the most important ethical matter about this these questions, the fact that people go in the, I read one of the passages, you know, they come in the post office and they drink, and this gets me mad, you are talking to them and they do not listen to you, so the fact that people in stores or you know, when you are at the cafe and ordering and you're on the phone, and this is something that is maybe very, very annoying, because it's really a matter of care and attention, and so there's a kind of strong incivility in that, because there are people you will give your attention and others less, and so of course it kind of creates or reveals a social hierarchy of people you can address to without leaving your phone, and others obviously obviously you want although, you know, sometimes when I have students, sometimes they get a phone call, they want to leave the room, and I find it very, very insidious. But some other people don't mind it. Anyway, so this is, I think, a very present and ethical matter, and so obviously this is something that we need to address, because it's really connected to the idea of care. But I had this, and it's interesting, about these matters of gender and the school harassment story, because there is this framework by these two women sociologists in France, Alexandra Pidin and Camille Gaillet, and they presented it a few months ago. And so it's about women who are in the French Paris subway, for example. So obviously sometimes they get arrest, but it's not really their case, because they have strollers with babies and that stuff. And so I don't know if you've been in the Paris subway, but it's very hard if you have a stroller or a suitcase because you don't have many elevators. And so I tell you, when someone offers to help, and it doesn't happen very often, they are very happy, but sometimes they are also a little cautious. And in some of the testimonies, which was very interesting, as they say, this guy, he was really nice and he helped me and I was very happy, and he was on the phone and he didn't even stop his conversation, but he helped me while talking. And this happened, it's not only once, in two or three of the conversations, and this woman felt much more comfortable being helped by someone who was in his phone call, because of course they felt safer somehow. So I think there are all these kind of new phenomena that are really worth having this kind of, you know, ethnography of ordinary life that now has to be shared both by sociology and philosophy. I'm sorry because I had a few remarks about the idea, the very idea of the apparatus, guys. I'm running very late, so I will keep this for the discussion. But obviously, if you have this apparatus, this guys has to lose this idea of something like a general spirit, because it's very hard to get rid of this connotation, and so this guys has to include this kind of ordinary ethics, texture of life, and public display of our values. Mm-hmm.